You want to wireframe your pitch the way you would an app. You want to speak deliberately and confidently, as confidence is really what gives you the authority when you're speaking. Make sure you test and check that the AV that's there is appropriate to what you have planned. You don't want to get on stage and realize that it's going to fall apart from the moment that you start. Make sure you practice. And then in terms of execution, it's really just about projecting confidence and gravitas, and that in a situation that usually happens, which is there will be some small errors that occur, you'll run into problems. You need to not panic. You need to adapt to the situation and continue on. So first is to know the rules. So every hackathon that exists, including AT&T hackathons, has varying rules. And those impact how you need to structure your pitch. So our hackathon, as an example, give about a third of the score specifically to the pitch, a third to creativity, and a third to technical difficulty and what technologies were used when you built. And so when you're looking at the rules, you need to ask, you know, how long do you have to pitch? At our event, you'll have 3 minutes. But that varies even at AT&T Hackathon. So the on-stage pitch you would see at the AT&T Developer Summer Keynote is down to a minute. And we've had some events where we allow up to 5 minutes. And so before you even put pen to paper in scoping something out, you need to know exactly how long you have. You need to know whether or not the hackathon requires a business case. And this is very important because most hackathons allow you to drop a business case compared to something like a startup weekend. But it's essential to know whether or not you're going to have that. If you only have 3 minutes to pitch, you spend 1 minute on a business case that's unnecessary, that's a lot of wasted time that you have to try and make up for. And so it's really important you know the exact scope of what you're supposed to present. The third is, are the judges focused on specific themes such as social good? You know, if there's something of that nature, you need to make sure that you're trying to tie your app in and do it as best as possible. If you ignore the theme, it's going to damage you pretty substantially, even if your app is clearly within the theme. It makes it so that every other team is making that much better of a case in comparison to yourself. And then in the same vein, are there any specific technologies that should be highlighted? This goes back to the concept of sponsors. You know, it really varies on sponsors whether or not they want you to heavily highlight something, as it can seem heavy-handed. But you need to look into that and ask that question. You know, if it's an event focused on Android, you know, it will matter that you're focusing that you built natively versus, you know, a hybrid mobile web app. And so highlighting that, if that's how you build, will give you a step up on the competition. So after you know the rules, you need to know the audience. And this has two really fold ways of how to do that. The first is, you know, look at what literature is available for the event and look at who the judges are. Who the judges are will tell you a lot about what they're looking for. If a judge is a developer, they're going to be very focused on the technical know-how of the app. If they're a designer, unsurprisingly, they'll be very focused on the design you created, making sure that, you know, it's pleasing to look at, but also that it's functional. And so the more designers you have as judges, the more you want to make sure you detail what you're doing to that and avoiding any screens that aren't cleaned up. A venture capitalist, and this one's tricky because going back to what I said before, business case is something you avoid when it's unnecessary. But if you have a three-judge panel and two of our venture cap experts, it's likely that even with the rules stating a business case doesn't matter, they're still going to look for it to some aspect. So it's very important that if you see them as judges, that you're highlighting why your app matters to a degree that isn't quite as necessary with other judges. And then last but not least is sponsors. And so the hackathon allows sponsors to participate as judges. Obviously, they're going to be looking for things around their technologies. So even if you use a technology from somebody like IBM and Microsoft that is not specifically being sponsored at that event, it's important to highlight it because at the end of the day, it's still something that they'll latch onto in their mind. I've seen it with judges that built using Microsoft Azure when the sponsor was from the Windows 8 team. It's very core to what they're doing, building out those developer communities. And so they're always going to be looking for things that are from their company, if not specifically from their team. And then last to that is knowing whether or not they're involved in the marketing or production of the specific technology. And that can go beyond a sponsor specifically only working for a company. You know, if somebody's out there and they've worked on smart tech, you know, including that and highlighting that matters a lot more when it's within their sector. So try and do some level of research on the judges if you can, and it'll put you in better position to deliver a good pitch. And then secondarily to that is that when possible, it's great to be able to actually speak to the judges in advance, because this will allow you to get an idea of what specifically they're interested in and what might impact their decision. So even if you have that research done, it could be that a judge's interest has shifted, or that they're really interested in some bleeding edge technology that you've included, but that you otherwise might, you know, bury the lead on. And so make sure that if you have that chance, you know, when you go grab lunch during the day, or, you know, in those last few hours as you're refining your pitch, that you do speak to them and make sure that what you're delivering is going to put the best foot forward. So once you have that information, you want to wireframe your pitch. And this is important because it really allows you to get things within the time limit and to make sure that no aspect of your pitch is a waste. And so the way I've laid it out here is an intro. You usually want to open with something that grabs the audience's attention rather than just an introduction. That gives you a leg up on everyone else, because then you have everyone's attention immediately, and you can really just dive straight in. You want to introduce your team. When you do that, be very careful to introduce just the team. I've seen a lot of pitches where people have 8 or 9 member teams, but if you introduce each member, that you could eat a good 30 seconds just doing that. And so as much as, you know, we all want to give you credit, and you will get that at the end, just make sure that you are reviewing it in a logical way. After you've done that, you want to immediately go to address, you know, speaking about what problem you are addressing. And this is really key to the event, because if we don't think you're addressing anything, no one knows why you built the app. And, you know, problems can be significant. They can be really powerful, or they can be, you know, what we all deal with in terms of boredom. And you really want to be specific in that. So if you built a game, generally you're addressing boredom, but you can also be addressing, you know, deficiencies in math or science, or, you know, allowing people to gain more knowledge in pop culture. And so making sure that you mention that is really important in terms of driving the audience forward. And then, of course, why should the problem even matter to a person? You know, connecting with the audience. You know, if it's a younger audience and it's a game, it's easy. If it's an older audience, it can be a little more difficult, but you really want to drive home why the app was built. Once you have that, you jump into introducing the app itself. And that's really, how does the app address the problem? You know, what is the app? What are the core features of the app? And what makes your app different from everything else that's in the market? And that can be really small differences or very large ones. And so you definitely want to spend some time on that. But keep in mind that you can continue that part of the conversation as you drive through the demo. And then once you've done that, that's when you're beginning the demo, and the demo should start directly with the core features. And I'll go over that a little bit more later on when I talk about the tricks to a demo. But just go straight in. You wanna get it fast. You have 90 seconds at our events. You know, at other events you're gonna have even less. So you really just need to go to what you built that matters and what makes it different. After you're done with that first feature, go straight into the second one. As you do these, make sure you're highlighting what technology you use in order to build them. And that especially rings true if it's sponsored technology. And then once you get through those core features, and in this example there's 2, but you could have 3 or 4, you want to talk about additional features or what you're looking to do with in the future with the app. And that's really time permitting. Your goal is to make it through the core features without running out of time, and anything after that point you should really look at as being additional, unless you find it to be paramount to something the judges are going to be looking for. So going to what I said, the trick to creating a good demo. And so the first is skip unnecessary screens. And the one I've highlighted here is the sign up and login screen. Unless it's really unique and you spend a lot of time building out some substantial backend in order to store this information, or, you know, you've gone on a limb in terms of what you built, it's really unnecessary to show it, and it eats a lot of time. especially sign-up screens. I've seen a couple teams spend over a minute trying to sign up for their own app, and it's just it's unnecessary, it's boring to watch, and it really bogs down your demo. So make sure that if you can, that you're just skipping through this. Log in advance, do whatever you can to try and skip through so you're going straight to what you actually built. And then be sure to mention, you know, what you use to build those core features, going back to what I said before. It's really important. If we're judging how technically difficult it was to build your app, we need to know what you did in order to build it. It's also a chance for you to highlight sponsor technology so that you can both please the sponsors, but also make it clear that you did implement something that might have been a requirement in order to compete in the event. And the third is to prepare your hardware and software prior to taking the stage. This is another one that I see a lot of teams run into, and that's making sure that everything's going to run from the moment you say go. You don't want to get up there and realize your server crashed and waste, you know, 20 to 30 seconds trying to launch it again. You don't want to go up there and realize you don't have your Wi-Fi connected, or that your phone has no cellular. You want to try and troubleshoot that in advance. So really make sure that, you know, as you're sitting watching pitches before you or as you're setting up, that everything is good to go before you start speaking, before that clock starts running. All right. And in that vein, make sure you check or test the AV prior to pitching. This is important for a lot of different reasons. In these pictures, you can see that AV at our own events has varied pretty dramatically. And as such, you never know what you're going to be able to do on stage. Probably the most common ask that I see that is really rarely available is to be able to show tools two screens simultaneously. You know, everyone wishes they could do that, but it's just outside of very large venues, it's rare that we have two projectors, two screens, and really the logistic capability to support it. And so asking whether or not those things are available as early as possible helps you troubleshoot how your pitch is constructed. Another one along those lines is whether or not there's audio in order to show something like a video or to show the audio that is on your app. So once you've done that, you should start practicing. When you practice, you want to make sure you're simulating your pitch as closely as possible. This is because you're going to notice some lulls, some things that you're saying that are redundant to something you said earlier. And you'll notice that occasionally you're missing some information. And so making sure that you're running through it the way you plan to run through it on stage allows you to kind of fight through that. When you do it, make sure you're timing it. I know that seems obvious, but a lot of teams run through it and kind of go by, it felt like 3 minutes, and you would be shocked at how short 3 minutes is, kind of like how long 3 minutes can feel when you cannot wait to leave a room. So make sure you're actually physically timing it. The time, as I said before, usually ranges between 1 to 5 minutes, which means that even a, you know, a 10, 15-second problem with your pitch can be pretty substantial, because that's what it is when it runs perfectly. You're in a very controlled environment. That means once you take a stage, you're probably going to run over that time. Some people panic and speak a little faster. I know I've been known to do that on occasion. But generally speaking, people add enough lulls. They forget things and kind of get lost in what they're saying, and they'll run long. So if you're not running on time, make sure that you get that cut. And the third is practice speaking while you're demoing. And this one is really, really important, especially in the cases where you're going to have somebody else manage the device while you're speaking. You need to make sure those things are in sync. You don't want to be forced to look away at the screen, away from the audience, just so that you can watch your own device to make sure that you're in sync. You know, running through that several times really helps. It also just helps in general for the person doing the demo. You know, as odd as it is, you built the app, you feel like you understand exactly how things are going to load. Sometimes things load faster or slower than you think. And so just making sure that you've ran through the actual demo, both in terms of speaking and the app itself, will help a lot. And I really can't recommend that specific form of practice enough. So, in terms of execution, you want to project gravitas when you're performing a pitch. And what does that mean? Well, you want to speak with authority. When you get up there, and that's pretty funny. So when you get up there, you want to speak with a firm voice and a high volume. It's really important that you're projecting that you know what you're talking about. If you start to run off or you end a statement with that weird form of tone of voice where it sounds like it's a question, everyone's going to lose a lot of confidence in what you're saying. It's going to become a lot harder for you to sell something to somebody. So make sure that as you speak, you're speaking at a consistent and firm voice and that you sound like someone that you yourself would listen to. You want to maintain eye contact. And so the reality is it's one of the most powerful forms of nonverbal communication. You want to make sure that the audience are engaged as well, and that's something that eye contact really delivers. And the third is you want to avoid wandering hands. This means keep your hands out of your pockets. I know a lot of times it's hard to do, but it really is something that distracts people. Even if you cross your arms in front of you, which is usually seen as defensive, it's a lot better than having them in your pockets. You want to avoid fidgeting. The really telltale thing for fidgeting in a hackathon is you'll see people that will fidget by picking up the phone that they're demoing on and start moving it around. And so it's just really dangerous in an environment where, you know, you're actually demonstrating something to have, you know, that kind of behavior. And so if you're uncomfortable in front of a group of people, you really just got to take a deep breath and focus on what you're actually doing. And the third is try to make every action that you actually take deliberate. So if you're shifting, it's going to draw people's attention, whether that's somebody that's speaking or not. And so if you go up there and you have five team members and one of them is constantly putting their arms in their pockets and then putting them across, if they're shifting around, if they walk across, it's going to take away from your demo every time that happens. So be very careful with that. All right, and last is make sure you don't panic. You need to adapt to the situation. You can't anticipate that everything's going to go perfect. As much as you can run through it, you're going to have some small things go wrong, whether they're technical in nature or whether you forget specifically what you're talking about. You just have to keep going. If you stop and pause, not only are you going to lose everyone's attention, but in addition, you're going to run into the problem where you're just going to run out of time. And so to that fact, make sure you have a plan on what to do if a screen fails or a server crashes. You know, it's always good to have a backup set of slides, a backup server already set up so you can flip it in. You just have to run through that and kind of plan for as many things as you can. I know you're on such a timeline that it's not that easy to do, but, you know, having something in place where, you know, if a screen fails, you have a cached version of the screen for a web app, that sort of small thing can be extremely helpful to allow you to keep moving forward and avoid falling into any kind of trap. And keep in mind that the audience feeds off your energy. If you're nervous, the audience is going to sense it. I'm sure people often sense when I get nervous, I'll speed up how I'm talking, or you run into, you know, weird quirks in the words you're saying. And so make sure that when you're talking with authority. And then if something breaks your focus or the focus of the audience, you need to try and pull it back in. You have to do it kind of immediately. The audience is going to be rooting for you, but that doesn't mean that it really allows them to expand their attention beyond what it normally is. And last but not least, you know, demo fails are just a way of life of hackathons. We've all been through them. You got to remember that that's the case and just keep pushing forward. And so, with all that said, does anyone have any questions?